I have with me Captain G S Rathee, who is from Delhi. He is a social activist. He has worked in the various departments of the government agencies, and today he has come to Bangalore. And thanks for coming, sir.
My pleasure.
Your purpose of visit here, you know that a lot of protests are going on against CAA, NRC and NPR. You being one of the social activists fighting for this cause, what is your take on this?
Well, first of all, I would like to thank that you are taking my viewpoints on this very crucial issue for the country. And I would only say that this is all a rubbish thing which has been inculcated in the country on the name of the CAA, and then further on it is being like the NRC is there and the NPR is there. So it is just only a matter of divide, the dividing of the country. And if we see the basic structure of the Constitution of India and the right from the first page, which is the preamble, so the first line says, "We the people of India." So it is just breaking up the basic concept of the unity and diversity of the country into this thing. So why are we trying to put up a differentiation between the Hindus and the Muslims? The humanity should be the first thing over here. Why to discriminate? So it is just a matter of discrimination and bringing up various kind of selfish kind of motives on the name of the CAA as well as the NRC and the NPR.
But the government of India and our Home Minister says that there is no cause of worry on CAA or NRC because it's not going to affect the minorities in India. What is your take on that?
Definitely, it is going to put up a lot of negativity on this thing. And I would say that whosoever is making up this or whosoever has made up this act basically and previously the bill, they should know, they should have done the entire, they should have made up an entire knowledge and read about the complete consequences, why they are trying to take it up and what are the things they want up. So, and what was the need of this thing in the country? We don't think so that there is any need in the country. We are already a diverse country. We have a diverse cultural society over here. We are living peacefully. Apart from that, there are bloody lot of other agendas in the country which need to be taken care, be it education, be it employment, be it hunger, poverty. So it is just like you are bringing up some kind of dark cloud to hide those basic issues and bring up these things.
You are well aware that in that act it is there that persecuted religious minorities except the Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think that, you know, this there should be some amendment to it? And do you think who will be coming from Pakistan, Bangladesh or from Afghanistan?
This is a matter of great concern that what is the basically the module and what is the modus to identify who is who. Suppose I am taking up the example of anyone coming from Bangladesh or Afghanistan. Any person who is coming from there, he will just come to the border or he will just say Jai Shri Ram. And on the basis of that, will you be able to see that this person is from the Hindu community or he is from the Christian community or he is from the Buddha community? If that person is a Muslim and he comes and shout, "I am Jai Shri Ram," will you be able to take up that person? And further on, don't you think that there will be a lot of infiltration into that thing? So most important aspect is to see that what is the modus of identifying the people. And according to this act and according to the whole exercise, there is no modus lying with the government. I can challenge any person from the government agency or anyone, they can come up and they should tell that yes, we have this kind of modus, we will differentiate the Muslims, Hindus and the other communities from this parameter. They don't have any kind of parameter. Will they be extracting the blood from the Muslim and they will be comparing with the Hindu? We are all human.
No, but you think infiltrators from Pakistan or Bangladesh should be coming to India in the guise of saying that they are belonging to a different religion except Muslims?
110%.
So do you think it's a danger?
It is a big time danger for the country. It is a danger, and this is I must not use this word, but I will say that it will be a legal infiltration. It will be legal infiltration of the terrorist groups and the insurgent groups on the Indian soil. And our government can't say no. because whosoever will be infiltrating over here in India, they will be well organized, they will be well trained to enter into India with proper set of documents and each and everything. So based on those documents and each and everything, there is no authority in the country or in the system which can say, which can't say no to them. They have to accept that.
What about the Muhajirs in Pakistan?
Muhajirs is they are really into very bad shape. Whosoever has left India during the time of partition, they have been called as Muhajirs over there, and they are given a basically a third degree treatment over there. So in actually what I say and what I feel, that if you are considering the Hindus to be Hindus, Christians, or those people to be coming over there, so what is the problem with those people? They are also living in destitute. They are also the part of the undivided India, who during the time of division they went to Pakistan. So they should also be brought up over here.
So these protests are going from the day the bill has been passed in the parliament, and now there has been an act has been also passed, and it has been notified also. Do you think this protest has any say, or will the government have a change of heart, or the reports that they are not going to do NPR shortly or NRC? Do you think it's going to happen?
Look, these people, whosoever came on the roads, they are not idiots. Everyone has the brain, and they have thought something, that thought something for unity of the country and for their generations, those who came over here. It is not a matter of one person, two person. It is a matter of millions and billions. So they have come on the roads to fight for their rights, which are enshrined in the Constitution of India, which says that India will be secular, democratic, sovereign, socialist, and republic nation. So we should adhere with that. And in the future also, if these kind of things are going to be, these the basic things of the Constitution will be attacked, we will be seeing the protest. The people, they are coming up, they are coming out of their houses, they are spending nights. If we take up the example of Delhi, the climate, the temperature has been just like in 2 degrees or even 1 degree over there. And I must salute the women power. They are sitting for more than a month over there in that sheer cold over there, and they are fighting for the rights. They are doing the peaceful protest. They're fighting for the rights. So the government should listen to them. They should have that kind of modus to sit in front of them. They should have the capability and the ability to face the citizen of the country. Why? They're not outsiders. Why they are afraid?
Coming to NPR bill, the survey is going to start. So the government says, and even the Home Minister says, nothing to worry. We are just a census. So how do you define that NPR?
Well, if you're talking about the National Population Register, so it itself is very much contradictory. Census is there. When census is there, what is the need of bloody NPR? If you say, no, we are adamant on bringing the NPR, then why did you brought up the Aadhaar card? The Aadhaar card itself is a very safe and very foolproof mechanism which identify the citizens of the country. Not only on the basis of their names or the father name or on their date of birth, but on the biometric as well. And almost 98% of the country is covered with the Aadhaar card. So what was the use of bringing up the NPR? So NPR, we must say that they have a malicious mindset, and this is the initial step into formulating the...
What is malicious? How do you define that in malicious and it's dangerous? Somebody comes to you to fill the form. How do you do it?
Well, suppose... if I'm taking the example of NPR, it is having certain set of the questions. If I say that they have 10 questions over there, and the government says that in the NPR, the official visiting you, they won't be taking up any kind of documents from you. They will just be asking whatever you feel comfortable, you answer them. If you don't feel comfortable, don't answer them. The officer is not going to force you to answer those questions. So suppose the officer come to me and he asked me that these are the set of 10 questions, and yes, number 1, number 2, number 3. I say that I'm comfortable with 3 questions only, and I'm giving the answer of 3, rest 7 I'm not interested. So he will say, okay, fair enough sir, tata bye bye. He will go over there to the office, they will see, and I will be put on the suspected category, which will be called as D. It will be D, means I have the deficiency into that. I have the deficiency into that. And further on, they will be sending me the notice that yes, this person seemed to be culprit into that thing. Why he is not supplying the correct information over there, and then they will ask me for the real papers from where I'm going to fetch them. If I'm unable to fetch them, then the further course will be, I will be detented, and then finally, if I'm unable to support that in the court of law also, then I'll be deported.
Where?
God knows.
So do you think that the government should sit down with all the parties, taking consideration the all the protest, try to see that there's some amendment, again pass it in the parliament, see that, you know, everything goes normal? Do you think that's only the procedure, or do you think that if it doesn't happen, what's going to be the situation?
Well, the first and the foremost thing is that when any bill is passed in the either of the houses of the parliament, so before the bill is when the bill is made, so it is thrown to the general public for asking for their comments and the suggestions. I don't think so anything has been asked over there. After making it as an act, now the government is asking for the suggestions and all the things. They have done a reverse process. Why is it so? So if they had asked for the comments and the suggestions beforehand only, they are quite sure that this bill would have never been an act. So that was the only malified intention, that the government like sidelined that kind of the factor, and they're asking on a reverse platform.
And even the Supreme Court has taken 4 weeks time. The bills have and the case has been posted to the higher constitution with 7 bench. So what is your take on that?
Well, first of all, referring to a 3 bench, then 5 bench, or then a 7 bench. So after 7 bench, there is nothing. It is one of the highest constitutional bench, and if the 7 bench says no, then it will be just like 110% you have to adhere and abide with that. So it is just like keeping up the time, passing up the time with that, and nothing more than that.
Do you think all this done for political gains or for appeasement, or do you think that there is no other issue this bill has been?
Well, everything has been done on the political grounds only. They are just keep only one thing what we see, that make up the saffronization, make up the Hindu Rashtra. But I fail to understand that those contractors of Hinduism, they doesn't know H of Hinduism and S of saffron. They doesn't know. It is the Hindu religion, it's very deep. So first of all, they should know that what exactly they want to achieve. So without having any knowledge of the achievement, they are throwing up these things. So it is just to keep up their chair safe, because the majority of the people in India, they are Hindus, and they just want to play with the emotions of the people just to gain up the votes and to keep themselves firm for the next 5 years and all the things.
Your message?
My message is that India is a united country, and we had been known for the unity in diversity, and vice versa in diversity in unity. And the most important thing is that we should look for the socio-economic development of the country rather than going on these kind of issues which are only meant for spreading the disparities. Let's unite India, not divide India. That's my main aim. And we are nation-centric citizens, and let's think about the country. Let's think about the constitution. Let's see that we are the all one, we the people of India. Let's stand with this word, we the people of India. And let's progress for the country.
Thank you for speaking to Nashyaman.
My pleasure.
Captain G S Rathee, of the view that NRC, NPR and CAA bill will get a lot of infiltration and other unwanted elements to the country, which is dangerous. He also said that we unity is in diversity. He wants a united India, and he says all this for political gains. And he says that as all things should be done as soon as possible, see that peace prevails and everything is back to normal. This is Rizwan Asad on Nashyaman News, Bangalore.